Hello, everybody, and thanks so much for joining me on another episode of 100 Days of Code with me, Lilly Code. Today is day 37, and we are continuing on with our Redux React application, where we've set up this cart and we are trying to add items to the cart and look at the total of the cart and track the state of the objects within this cart. So whether or not something has been added to the cart and how many items have been added to the cart, the price of the cart, or the items in the cart. So we're doing all this tracking of the state of these objects. So like the things I just mentioned, using Redux, and we've implemented that in a React application. So Redux allows you to track the state of something across your whole application. So in this case, whether or not there is something in the cart and the current status of all of the objects in that cart. So that's what we're doing at the moment. And we have a few errors when we're adding items to the cart. So if I click add cart here, we'll get an error. And the error I'm getting is that the default toggle is not a function. And we get the same error if we try and add an item to the cart. So I was just trying to look at the cart there. And then we have the same error, but it's in a different place. So default add item to cart is not a function. So we're being told that our functions for adding these items to the cart are not functions. So I don't see anything wrong, right, with the code so far. So we're going to just continue on, but I'll tell you why I don't see anything wrong with it here. So basically we have our cart slice and our UI slice, which is tracking the state of two different parts of the component of the app that we're building, this cart app, you know, we're making a cart app. And those two slices come together in an index.js file, which is where we tell it all of the things we want to manage the state of when you're using React and Redux. So in this case, we're using Redux to track the state of different things in the application. And this is all captured in the store. And you configure a store, which is where you tell it what it is that you want to store the information of. So here we have our reducers, and our reducers, we've passed it an object because we've split these up into two separate files for better management of our code. So we have a UI slice and then a cart slice. So here's our UI slice and our cart slice being imported. Okay, that shouldn't make any difference. We just have a single and a double quote there. That's fine. And then into the reducer methods. So this is an action creators for the types of actions that are handled by the slice reducer. So within our different slices, then we have our cart and our UI slice. We have this array of objects called reducers, and these are run using the dispatch method that comes with Redux as well. So when you dispatch your reducer, you're running that function and it's tracking the state of the thing as well, once you set it up in order to do that. So we have a reducer here, and our function that we want to run, if we run or dispatch this reducer, add item to cart, we pass in a state and an action, and then we want to just track the addition of the item to this cart. So we're taking in this new item, which we're just literally is the action.payload. So what's coming in here, and we're assigning that to new item, and then we're checking if we already have this item. And in the case that we do not have the new item, we're adding that into the array of objects. And if we do have the existing item, then we're just updating the quantity and the price of that item to account for the additional item being put in. So if you had one baguette and it was a euro and you added two baguettes, well, baguette is already listed in the array of all the objects that we have. So we have baguette in there. So we just change the quantity to two baguettes and the total price to €2 because we have two of them now. So that's what that bit of code there is doing. And then we have our remove item from cart reducer, which again is just checking whether or not we have this item and removing it from the object and updating the totals and the prices and things like that for when we remove that item. So well, actually we're just coming in here. The item that goes in is assigned to the ID. We check if it has an existing item. We remove the one item from the total quantity because we're taking that thing away. And then if we already have one of these items, then we want to check if the existing item dot quantity is equal to one, then we want to filter out the items based on the ID and check that it's, if we have something that isn't of the same ID. And then otherwise, we just want to reduce the quantity by one. So minus minus is just reduce the quantity by one for that particular existing item. So I don't really see what's going wrong here, right? And then we export the actions for the cart slice. So each of the slices has actions, which is just pointing to these different actions here, to the reducers that we can call. So we assign that to a constant, and then we can use this elsewhere. So in our cart item over here, which is one of the places we're having this problem when we try to add to cart, we have this add item cart handler, which is clicked, which is used when you click on a button that's going to run that handler. So here we have a plus button, which is to add another item to the cart. So when we click that button, we run this add item handler, which is an arrow function we've set up here, and that's dispatching, which is just calling the reducers or the reducer functions wherever you've specified it. So we're saying here, go to the cart actions and run the add item to cart, and we want to pass in the ID, the title, and the price. So in order to get all that working, we should import our cart actions. We need to use dispatch because we are dispatching it. So I just can't really see what's going wrong here at the moment. But what we're going to do now next anyway, because I'll just continue, because I've been looking at this. I wanted to try and figure out what was wrong so I could come back with a solution and explain how I fixed it. But I've been looking around and I don't actually see the problem just yet. So it will come to me. We're obviously going to have to fix this. So we'll just continue on, and we're going to implement Firebase now within our project. And what Firebase is going to do is allow us to store data or information in an actual backend. So we're going to be interacting with Firebase now and storing all of our data in a backend, as opposed to in dummy arrays where we just have hard-coded information and we've put it into our code here. We're going to pull that data back from a server. So that's going to be a really exciting advancement onto this project, and I'm looking forward to getting into it. So let's do that now. Okay guys, so we're just going to get Firebase set up to do this. So if you just Google Firebase, you can see here one of the first links we have, firebase.google.com. So this is what we're going to use, and it's a really easy way to just start using a backend, you know. So there we go, I already have a project there, but I'll create a new one. So this can be called Max Complete React, because that's the course that we're currently doing. So I'll just continue. That's fine. We can enable Google Analytics. That's okay. It can come in handy for other projects, but to be honest, I haven't used it loads. So I'll create a new account here and use that. And we are set in Ireland. So cool. And I accept the terms and conditions. Could be signing away my life. No, I'm sure it's fine. So yeah, we just tick those boxes and move on out. So while this is just getting set up here, I'm just listening to the video. Okay, perfect. So I can just click the create database button. That's absolutely perfect. And then where do you want your real-time database to be stored? Well, United States, Belgium, or Singapore. I mean, I guess it doesn't really matter, but I have heard that some of the servers are carbon neutral or have a lower carbon footprint. So really, Googling and finding out which one of these is best for the environment might be a good approach. But I'm just going to go crazy and click Belgium because, hey ho, up the Belgiums. Yeah, I don't know. I'm just picking any particular one. So once you've defined your data structure, you will have to write rules to secure your data. Okay. So, okay, we will start. We'll start in test mode, because then in 30 days, I need to update the database in order to give the proper rules that who can read and who can write to this database. But for the moment, I'm just going to make it free, and within 30 days, I need to add this configuration. So if you're starting with Firebase and you're Googling this, like they'll tell you how to set up that configuration because it's a necessary step. But I'm going to just start in test mode so we can just get going here. So I'll enable that and we can continue. Okay. So the whole aim of this, creating this database, is when we add and remove items, we're tracking it somewhere in a database. So we can add and remove items and store all that information in this database. So that's what we're going to set up now. And then once we reload the project, we'll be fetching that data back from the database. So okay, so in order to send this data back to the database and to store it there, the data that we're updating, so the items that we're putting in our cart is the data in this particular instance, that's going to be an asynchronous function because we need to send it over and then it'll send back whether or not it was successful. So we can't do that type of logic within our reducers. Your reducers should be, I don't want to say simple, but they should just be pure functions with no side effects, no asynchronous code. So they should just do what they're doing. Don't put anything else into these reducers other than what you need to put in there. So it should just be going through this, executing line by line, and able to get to the bottom and finish this particular block of code. There shouldn't be any asynchronous functions happening, which is where you're interacting with the server or something like that, and you're waiting for information back. So there's two different places where we can add this type of functionality to interact with a server when you're using React and Redux together. And that's inside either the component itself by using something like use effect, or the second way to do it is by inside an action creator. So we've already used these action creators before, but we're going to use it again now. So we'll see what all of this means now in a moment. So we're going to have a look at both ways of implementing this through either the use effect and also through action creators. So we'll see both of those methods now. So I'll just close off everything else and we'll just look at the product item for the moment. So if I just click this product item and do close others, it should close everything else, and then I can close all over here and we're just left with the file that we want. So here we have our add to cart handler, which is dispatching the cart actions and adding an item to a cart, which we've seen we have some issues with. But by trying to add this in asynchronously now, let's just see what happens. So yeah, so we could add it in here in this dispatch and add it in here to send it back to the back end, but we have a lot of stuff going on within our cart slice here, and what we're doing is checking if we already have that item and updating the total price if we do and things like that, or if we do have one of those items already in the cart. So none of this logic will be brought over if we just add it from our product item. So we will update our back end in order to do some of this logic for us. Excuse-moi. So Max is still just explaining all this concept here at the moment, so basically our front end code is dependent on our back end code, and they're interacting with each other. So because this is mainly a front end application that we've been building, and we don't have the back end skills to go and fully, you know, alter this data coming into the back end, we can do all this on the front end because that's what we're practicing at the moment, is the front end stuff. So we'll end up doing some of the logic just in the right place on the front end, and being aware that these two things are connecting and that they need to tie in seamlessly, and they're going to be needing things to be stored in a particular format in the back end and things like that. So we have to set all that up, which is what we're going to do. So yeah, we either have the option to make the back end do some of this work or the front end, but we're going to go with the front end route because that's what we're most well versed in from practicing this course. Okay, so what we could do is use selector here and get our current cart before it's been updated, and then do the actions that we want to do on this cart before sending it to the back end. So that's one approach. And then we would send a request. Okay. So he's just talking through some code at the moment, which he says we're not actually going to use, but he just wanted to show it to us. So I'm just having a quick look. Okay, so I'm just still listing. I'm going to speed them up from 1.5 to 1 point, or to 2, so he can get through it a bit quicker. But just in case I miss something, you know, I don't want to just skip ahead and possibly miss something that we're going to need. So it's best that I listen. Okay, so one thing we do have to do is in our cart slice, when we're going to be sending this new updated information, we need to add another reducer, and the reducer is going to edit the cart or replace the cart on the back end. So we'll add in a function to do that. So replace cart, and this is going to take in a state and an action. Yeah, like all of the reducers. And then we just open up our curly brackets. I'll add a comma because you can chain these different reducers. You can have many different reducers that can be dispatched when you're working with your state. So in this replace cart one, what we're going to do is get the state total quantity of the total quantity we currently have and replace that with the action.payload.totalQuantity, because this will be an updated value. And then we also just want to do the same for our items. So state.items is equal to action.payload. So the information coming in when we go to replace this cart will send in this particular information and .items. So cool. We will be expecting those things whenever we call this replace cart function. Okay, so now we're going to see the recommended approach to this. Okay, so for the time being, I'm just going to comment this out because I'm not sure whether this is part of the recommended action. I think we still should need it, but let's just watch and make sure. Don't want to be introducing any more errors. Okay. Okay. Okay, cool. So what we can do is in our app.js, we can use a selector, which we are already doing here. Yeah. So we'll use selector and we will track the state of our cart. And then by using use effect also, we can see when this particular cart changes. So we can just add in use effect as well. Okay. Yep. And then we'll create another constant called cart and equal this to use selector in order to get some of the different functions that we have over there in our cart. We want to pick a particular part of it with this use selector. So will this just do the word? No. Will this just do the word? No. Okay, use selector. And then this is, we're going to take in our state. So I'll just put these into parentheses, state, and it's an arrow function, and state.cart. So we want to check the state of the cart. So cool. Okay. And use effect is actually coming from React. It's not coming from React Redux. So I will duplicate this line and just import it from React, not React Redux. Yes, because use effect is a React hook. Of course it is. Yeah. So we'll just save that. And now we can use effect. So what we want to do in here, I should have another open and curly bracket here, or parentheses. Okay, and then what we want to do is do our fetching in here. So fetch the data from our database in here. So we will fetch, and then you pass it in a URL. Okay, and so it looks like this is the name of our database. So if I paste that URL in there, yeah, I think so. And then we want to send it a file where to look. So we're going to pass a cart.js, which we will be creating this. And then this is going to get back an array. Okay, and what we can do here is pass through a method as well. So you can have a post or a put and or other methods as well, get, delete. But in this case, if we were to use a post, we will be adding the cart.js to the database. Whereas if we set the method here to put instead of post, it's replacing the cart.js, whereas post would add the cart.js to the database again. So we add that in like that. Then we have our closing curly parentheses. And that's the wrong bracket. And then this should be a circle. Parentheses. Okay. So I'll just move this object down because we're going to add some more stuff in here. So we have our put method being sent, then we'll do a comma and we'll also add the body. So what we want the body to be sent as, and this is going to be json.stringify. So we're going to send over that data in a stringified format. and the data we're going to send is the cart. And then this entire use effect is reliant on the cart. So we give it that dependency, we tell it it's reliant on the cart, and we save that. And then every time the cart changes now, this use effect will be run. So perfect. Okay. So let's just see how this is actually doing. If we save this, this should actually work now. So if we add an item to the cart, let's see what happens now. Okay. So we have an error there that put is not defined. So yes, yeah, so this should be passed as a string, like so. So we'll save that, okay, and reload the page and try and add something to the cart. So unhandled rejection, failed to fetch. Okay, so it doesn't like that for some reason. So so it's saying fail to fetch, and it's also saying it's been blocked by cores policy. So if that's our problem, then we'll just have to figure this out. So let's just check usage. Oh no, so this is the usage of the actual database. I thought that was going to be like help on how to use it. So we'll just open up Go to Docs in another tab here. Guides. Let's check out the guides. Fundamentals. Add Firebase to your apps. Cool. Web. Okay, so we did not npm install Firebase anyway, so we best do that because we are going to need it, it seems. So yeah, we haven't done any of the setup actually for Firebase, so we should probably do that. So I'll just go into my folder here. So we cd into code and then into 01. This is the folder where we've been running this project, and I'll just paste in that npm install to add Firebase to our packages in order to allow us to use Firebase. And then initialize Firebase in your app and create a Firebase app project. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, so that's still going there. Okay, so we'll do an npm auto fix just to run what the recommended command here is. It says to run npm auto fix, so we'll do that, and that's just going to help fix any of the different package errors that have come up. So maybe we have an older version installed, or we need to update something, and this will go and update a lot of those things that may be wrong in our package.json, or there could be a better newer version to be used, or maybe something's been deprecated. So that's all that that does, and then we can just fire up our project again with npm start. So yeah, let's go for a different port because I'm messing about here. Okay. So we still have an error. Failed to fetch, so that's okay, but let's go and figure out what is wrong here. So it can't fetch from this URL that we've passed it, and I think I just haven't set up Firebase correctly. So let's just Google this first piece of information, because this should give us a lead. So it can't find the core's policy. I've had this error before, and it's like just a weird error. Like, someone out there is probably like, it's not weird, it's just because of this. But I find it weird. It's when you're trying to communicate with servers or communicate with some sort of a backend that I get this error, and then I've solved it by like installing a plugin which just got around that core's policy the last time. But so basically we're not getting back an okay status. It's not saying okay, yes, you can communicate with me, the server. So, but I just don't know whether this is the problem or we just haven't set up Firebase correctly. But basically I'll copy it and I'll search for it, and we'll just see what's going on. So I'll paste this in here and search, and then I'll just add Firebase and React, because they're the two technologies that we're trying to actually do this in. So with React, oh geez, and Firebase. Okay, and here we go. Here's someone who's had this exact same error on Stack Overflow, which is a great place to look. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. Yeah, look, I don't have any of this set up, you know. Or any of this. So I'm not telling it anywhere to use cores. Like, we haven't set up our Firebase properly. So that's the issue. So yeah, first of all, we have to set this up, but I'm just wondering at what point in the course did I like skip ahead to that, you know? Well, I just decided to come down to chapter 18, so I did just skip ahead. So clearly somewhere in the middle, Max has set up his project in order to be able to use Firebase. So let's just go back to the documentation and set this up together. So here we go, add Firebase to an app, a web app. Cool. And I'm just going to I've done this before, so this really shouldn't be too bad. Okay guys, so I've gone back and found out where Max set up this initial Firebase product. So I'm just going to follow along with what he's doing. At the moment, he's testing out So the first thing is we can't seem to request things from our database. Fail to fetch, so we can't actually fetch that information. It's been blocked, and I don't think we've set up our Firebase correctly anyway. So what I'll do is just continue with what he's doing to make sure that we haven't missed anything. So the first thing that he's doing here is he's using this test API in order to check the requests that he's sending. So the test API is called swappy.dev. Cool. And in here, great, it's like a test API, so you can use this swappy.dev and request back this information. So if I copy this and then have /people/1, this is the information I should get back. So I should get back all of this data. So let's just see if that works by putting that into our fetch URL instead and seeing, is it our Firebase setup or can we fetch something? So let's see if we can fetch something. So every time the cart updates, we should go to this particular fetch URL because it's on tracking the state of the cart. So I'll just save that. We'll come back to our project. We will reload and I'll empty the cache and reload while I'm at it. And let's add, okay, so it doesn't, okay, so my comma or closing comma is in the wrong place, or apostrophe. So I'll paste that in there. That should be inside that parenthesis. And there still is something wrong. So now let's just do a get, because I want to get this information. I don't want to actually put it, because we're not adding anything to this back end. And then that's just the way we want the data back. This should not be here. Yeah, okay. So then if we save and let's, can we console log out in here as well? Let's just see first what happens now. So on line 12, an expected an assignment or function call. Oh yes, yes, yes. So this shouldn't be there either. This is actually all being passed. Yeah, so like that. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so we need to pass actually the URL and then what we want to happen. So we want the method to be a get, and then we want the body to come back as json.stringify, and we're tracking the cart object there. So request with a get head method cannot have a body. Okay, so we shouldn't have a body if we're just getting this information. So let's get rid of that and see what happens and save. Okay, and now if we add to cart, we still have an error. Okay, so I'm going a bit like rogue, but that's okay. Yeah, that's okay. So we'll come back to our app.js and I'll just follow along here with what he's doing for a moment. Okay, yeah, so just by using fetch, this is built into the browser, and this allows you to handle HTTP requests across the browser. So fetch in the Mozilla documentation. Let's just type in Mozilla. Okay, and here we go. And we've already looked at this. I've done a video on this previously, more tutorial style based, where I went through a fetch HTTP request. So check that out if you want to see that. That's in the ABC of coding, one of my previous videos. But we'll just continue looking at this here. So basically, this is just a way to handle these HTTP requests in the browser. So, yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to actually set this up as we're doing here, and just to see this working. So I'm going to add a button myself. Okay, and then on this button, I'm going to say click me, and then I'll add some associated information when we click this button. So what I'm going to do is start off by declaring a handler that can handle the fetching of this data from the back end. So we were doing this with useEffect. We'll just leave that for the moment. So I'll comment that out. Come down here and say function. Yeah. Fetch movies handler. And this is just a function. And in here we want to use fetch. Okay. And then in here we should pass in the URL. Okay, so I didn't even use the proper API last time, or the proper URL, I should say. So that's could have been a reason why we weren't getting that back, but I don't think it was. So I'll just continue on with what I'm doing here. So the URL that we want to get this from is /API and then films. And then we need to pass in the options as well. So this is going to be an object. So we'll say method and get, which is the default. So we don't actually have to add this in, but we'll just add it in to display exactly what's happening here. So then if I connect this to my button, we should run this fetch movies handler on click of the button and see those movies being fetched. So let's. So, yeah, what we should do, seeing as this is going to return a promise, is give it its dot then. So once we get that information back, once we fetched it, then what do we want to do? So in here, we'll say then we get a response, and we want to get the response.body. Okay, so what we want to do is, once we've got our response, we want to return response.json. So just return back the information that's there in JSON format. So we'll run the JSON on that, like run the JSON function in order to convert that or give it back to us in a JSON format. And then we want to add another dot then to tell it what to do after that. So then in here, yep, we have another dot then, and in here what we want to do, so we can actually just bring this down as well for ease of reading, like that. And well, that wasn't the exact right indentation, so I'll leave my closing parenthesis there, close my other parenthesis there, and then put in the information in the next dot then. So here we want to get our data, and the object, the way the object is structured, we have the data underneath the results, so we'll just access data.results. And if we go back to this test API, I can show you this now in a minute. So okay, and we also need to use state, so we'll import use state from React as well, and then we can declare that. So use state is equal to, we want to use state, and what this should be is our movies, and then set the movie. So we'll declare a constant called movies, and then the method to update the state on this will be called set movies. So we'll add that in as well, set movies, and this is equal to use state and starting with an empty array. So we'll just set that up, and then we can use this state down below. So once we have our data dot results down here, yeah, so once we have our data, and I'll just put this into curly brackets like this and open up my opening and closing curly parentheses here within my function, and that's okay. What we want to do is set the movies to this data coming back, so the data.results. So we've stored that somewhere, we've tracked the state of it, and then we can save those changes. And what we also want to do is just transform the data coming back, so we have it in the exact format that we want to save this in. So we'll add that in here as well. So we'll declare another constant called transformed movies. So we're just going to get this movie information back from this test server. So data.results and then .map. And what we want to do is change this information into a new structure. So what we'll do is we'll get our movie data, which is coming back from the server, and we'll return a new object with this, and the ID and this should be a open in parentheses as well, and then what we want to return is this. So this can be tabbed back. So our ID, and then I'll worry about them parentheses now in a minute. So our ID is going to be movie data dot episode underscore ID. Title is going to be movie data dot title, and then opening text is going to be movie data dot opening text. Cool. And then we also want the last piece of information coming back, which is our release date of the movie, and this is going to be movie data dot release underscore date. And this should actually be, because the way it's coming back from the back end is opening underscore crawl. and we want to change that to the name of opening text. So that's what we're doing here. We're getting it back in with the property opening crawl, and we want to assign that to a new property opening text just to have it in the vocabulary that we want it in. So we're missing a semicolon here. This should be outside of this, because if we match it up here, we had our opening closing parentheses curly bracket here, then we have another curly bracket, and then we have our rounded parentheses. So we just had them set up in the wrong way because I later added the other parentheses to capture the whole function block, and then we had our return with our opening curly and closing curly parentheses as well. So we've just updated that, and then we'll add in our semicolons as well, just so we know that they're where they're supposed to be. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then with this button, which should just fetch the movies, which this should be displayed at the very top of our page. So where I'll actually display this is just underneath the cart. Okay, and save. And then we'll go back and just see if that's doing anything. So I'll just reload this page, give it a hard reload. So, reference error, use state is not defined. So use state. Okay. So this should not be another equals. And we have imported use state from React. So I don't think that shouldn't be another equals. Yeah, of course. So what this should be rather than another equals is, this is use state, and you're saying you want to use state, which is a function that's going to do something, and you're initializing it as an empty array. You're passing it in an initial empty array. So there shouldn't have been two equals in the same line there. So that was definitely giving us some errors. And here's our click me button, which should go and get that data for us. So it's not getting any information back. So let's just go to our test URL and check if we go there. Can we get these films, you know? So if I copy this, we're trying to fetch data from this particular URL. So if I just paste this in, here's the films. Here's the way this is going to be coming back to us. So we can see there's our opening crawl and our episode ID and our release date. So this is the information that we're getting back from the server by sending or requesting at this URL. So you can see that information there, the way we're getting it back. So one thing I'll just do as well, seeing is this definitely isn't doing anything. This is optional. So when you're fetching, you pass in the different things. So what method you're trying to do. So you could be get, posting, putting, deleting, you know, all the different ways that you want to interact with that data in your database. So you send in information here, and you can send in other information like what the body should be and stuff like that. But the default fetch method that runs is a get method. So for the moment, we'll just take that out to hone in here on what's going on. So then we have our response, and we just want that to be transformed into a response.json. That looks perfectly fine. And what we want to happen with that is, then once we have that back, we want to get that data, assign it to a transformed movies variable, and what this variable is going to be is a list of objects where we have changed the names to each individual entry is a movie data. We've mapped over calling it movie data, and we're returning it in this format. So for the movie data dot episode ID, this here, we're renaming that to just ID, and then the movie data dot title, we're renaming that to title. The opening crawl, we're renaming that to opening text. And then the release date, we're renaming that to just release and uppercase date. And the reason why movie data is the first thing and then we have dot access and all these properties is because we've given it that name movie data within our own project here. So as we map over each of these items in the list, we're calling it movie data, movie data, movie data, movie data for each of these pieces of information coming back, which will just be sent back in one big JSON, but for each of the objects in that list then. And then these episode ID, the properties, the dot properties that we are accessing come from the back end because, or from this URL, because that's the way the data is being sent back to us. So here we're just trying to rename that. That should be fine. And then we want to set the movies to the data.results. So, okay, which is just the data we had coming back to begin with. So if we go back here, reload, and let's just check out what happens. Cannot read properties of undefined reading results. So it's not getting any data back, it seems. So what if I console log out here, data, and see what it is. Console log data, and I'll actually just stick a string in here as well, few errors, so we know what we're looking at. And then I'll also add another console log within the response just to check out that we're getting this first response back as well, so to see if it's fallen over somewhere. So console log, although I would suspect we would have a different error, we should be getting our response back, because otherwise it would have fallen over up here is what I'm guessing. So then response, we'll console log that out as well, and we'll save and we'll press that again and do that again and see what happens. So we've just got a load of stuff that we're not using. That's okay. And then I'll just click this button again. Okay, great. So we do have a response coming back. Super duper. Look at that. Okay, great. And here's our response. Great. So that's working. We are sending the request to the URL and we've got back a status of 200. So it's got that data. So that's absolutely super. We're getting somewhere. So now we just need to figure out why it can't extract that data. But we will do that. So we'll figure that out now. So what we're doing at the moment is just setting up the Firebase backend in order to interact with data from an actual server, from a database where we're storing it. So we will continue setting up Firebase tomorrow. I know I didn't get very far with this, but just trying to figure out what's going on, to be honest. So these things don't always take time, you know. I mean, they do take time. I'd be trying to set something up many times in the past and think, oh, that's grand, I'll have a database up in a day. Logically, these things take longer, especially when you're not fully versed with it. You know, you need to work your way through the situations and the problems you see along the way. So we're getting there, we're learning, and I'm sure by the next hour we'll have it set up. So do continue to come back and keep in the loop with what's going on. But thank you so much for watching. I appreciate you all and have an absolutely wonderful day. Bye from Lilly Code. Thanks, guys.